I'm Sarah King. I'm the Sustainability Coordinator for Arts and Sciences, and I'm here to welcome you to today's Knowledge by the Slice, our lunchtime talk. The Knowledge by the Slice series is sponsored by the School of Arts and Sciences to give the campus, the community, a chance to hear from some of the school's really outstanding faculty members. And today, that outstanding faculty member that we're featuring is Associate Professor of Earth and Environmental Science, Dr. Ben Horton, and he'll be addressing the question, is sea level rising? I'm really excited about this. Professor Horton's research focuses on the relationship between climate and sea level change. He and his collaborators have been working to understand the factors that have been involved in bringing about sea level changes in the past in order to enhance our ability to predict changes in the future. And following Professor Horton's talk, we'll have time for some audience Q&A, so enjoy the pizza and be ready to ask questions later. And now I'll turn things over to Dr. Horton. Thanks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for the introduction. Enjoy your pizza. I noticed there was no Hawaiian pizzas today. I have a bit of a problem with fruit on pizzas, but anyhow. So today I'm going to talk about sea level change. I work in the Department of Earth and Environmental Science, and I'm director of the Sea Level Research Laboratory, which employs postdocs, grad students, and many undergraduates. So today I'm going to talk about sea level rise. We're going to talk about sea level, the projections into the future. We're going to talk about what's happening at present. And being from an earth science department, what I hope to stress to you is that if we're going to fully understand the relationship between climate and sea level, we need to move beyond the instrumental period that we observe and go back into time. Now, if we're going to talk about sea level, you're going to get into the realm of debate regarding climate change. Now, it is very unfortunate that despite the huge amount of data that our climate is changing in the 20th century, and that it is due to human-induced factors such as the burning of fossil fuels, there is the odd scientist, an increasing number of policymakers, and a large body of the general public that think the science behind climate change is flawed. So we have a quote here from a potential presidential candidate, Texas Governor Rick Perry, that regarding climate change, he says the science is not settled on this, goes on to say, to me, it is just nonsense. So why would a presidential candidate think this regarding climate change? Well, I think the catalyst or the sort of changing aspect regarding climate change revolved around the Copenhagen UN Climate Change Conference in 2009. This was supposed to be a celebration of what we knew about climate change. The community was supposed to come together regarding adaptation and mitigation mechanisms. However, in the lead up to the conference, there were controversies regarding data quality, and we had the climate gate where emails were stolen from a variety of scientists, and when looked at in details were certain terminologies such as the word trick that was used that sort of alarmed the general public. We had issues to do with managements and conflicts of interest of people who were sitting on the Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change, the IPCC. We had problems with the analysis. Non-peer-reviewed information appeared in their reports, such as the melting of the Himalayan glaciers. So we had all these controversies prior to this summit. Then we had huge media coverage, which marked a tipping point in the relationship between scientists and the general public. And I think now, not only is it appropriate for scientists to continue to publish their research in peer-reviewed journals, we now have to interact with the general public. Giving this lecture is one of those such examples, but I think that if you are fortunate enough to produce a high-profile publication, you have to engage with television, radio, newspapers. You have to start to interact with the with internet sites. So we were fortunate enough, and this is going to be the topic of this presentation, that in June of this year, we published a publication in the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. So this paper, I don't know whether you can read this, but this paper was, the first author was Andrew Kemp. He was a graduate student at UPenn, had a Benjamin Franklin Fellowship, went on to do a postdoctoral position with me, and now is at Yale. And we wrote a paper based around his PhD that showed a continuous record of sea level variations over the last 2,000 years and related it to climate. And we said some things in that paper stating that sea level rise in the 20th century went up at around 2.1 millimetres per year, and it was the steepest increase in sea level for over 2,000 years. And that is quite an important piece of scientific information. Now, this isn't an error. I searched this article for carbon dioxide, and we found no examples of this. And this is just something I'm going to come on to in a couple of slides. Because if you are fortunate enough to produce a high-profile publication, you have to be aware that you're then going to be subject to attack from climate skeptics. So a couple of days after this after our paper was published, this particular website, it's one of the Heartland Institutes, the funders of the Tea Party, says that climate liar Ben Horton says that rising temperatures are the reasons behind higher sea levels. So I found that quite interesting, because I'm sure if I did a poll here and I said to you, right, okay, what happens if temperatures go up to ice? I think you'd all say that it melts. And if meltwater goes into the oceans, then I would sure that you'd then be able to work out that sea levels rise. But they don't decide to agree with this. They say this is an American bunch of lies, real scientists, Nazis, American and British. Well, they got right that I'm British, but I am also a psychopath. So beware when we're doing the Q&A, if you say something that I don't like, remember that they've worked out I'm a psychopath. But then they go on to say something quite interesting. They talk about this, the Gulf Stream. Gulf Stream, and I'm going to say his name twice already in this presentation, was first described by Benjamin Franklin when he was Postmaster General. He noticed that there was this warm flowing water from the Caribbean Sea out into northwestern Europe. And they are suggesting that the Gulf Stream controls sea level. And indeed, they are correct. Spatial variability in sea level rise will be related in part to the strength of the Gulf Stream. We have a project with NASA trying to address this. If the Gulf Stream speeds up, the rate of sea level rise will be greater on the Atlantic on the US Atlantic coast compared to the European Atlantic coast. We then can go on to another website, and this is the What's Up With website, What's Up With That website, and they have this quote saying, as there's no archive of their reconstruction results. Well, I took particular offence to that, because I don't know how you guys know how academia works. Well, we write papers in peer-reviewed journals. The journals then have this information, and the universities buy those journals. So universities such as Penn, an institution with large wealth, buys many journals, which you guys all have free access to. But other universities that don't have that wealth may be not able to buy a journal from the National Academy. And indeed, individuals who are outside those institutions cannot access it. So if an individual outside a university wanted to access the paper that we had bought, it would cost somewhere in the order of $30. So we thought, well, we actually don't like that. So we paid many thousands of dollars to the journal to make it freely available. So anybody can go onto their website and download our paper. And in the paper is a table that has each individual year for the last 2,000 years and what the sea level is. So that's a complete and utter lie. And then they said, well, because there wasn't, I digitized the results. And here's their graph, okay? It looks a bit prettier than mine because it's got a nice beach behind it. But they are saying that from 1900 to 2000, we've got an over a 3 meter rise in sea level. A 35 millimeter per year rise. But the abstract to my paper said it was 2.1. So a downright lie. And then the next thing, they say the authors go on the witch hunt, where the witch hunt name is anthropogenic carbon dioxide. The word carbon dioxide didn't appear once in the paper. So these websites can just basically take whatever information, completely and utterly lie about it, and then because this website's been going for quite a long time, it's got a flashy banner, people can think that it's reputable information. You then can go on to another website, Climate Audit, and we get these numerous comments from the general public or regarding our publication, coming from an analytical chemist with a strong background in statistics. this is no different than any other the crap published by this group. And, you know, I'm really pleased you're an analytical chemist. Maybe some of you here are majoring in chemistry. And fantastic that you've got a background in statistics. But I have a real problem that why would an analytical chemist think they know more about sea level than me? I mean, I've spent 15 years of my life. I got a PhD from a reputable university. I've published 100 peer-reviewed papers. I work at UPenn. I know what I'm talking about. I mean, I had back surgery 2 years ago. I had a real bad back problem. I actually collapsed in an intro lecture here at Penn. And I went to a doctor to get an opinion on this, and he said you needed surgery. I didn't like that, so I went to another doctor. He said I needed surgery. I went to another doctor. He said I needed surgery. Consensus of opinion was that I needed surgery. What I didn't do was go to a car mechanic. He may be very good at fixing cars, but he knows nothing about my back. Then you get these other comments. The geomorphology of North Carolina is that of a submergent coast. Spot on. Fantastic comment. The North Carolina coast is submerging, and we spent a great majority of that paper addressing this. So was this addressed in the Horton study? Yes. And then they say it would help if they release their data. What I would say, it would be helped if you read my paper. And then you go on to the third one, and you get a lot of these sort of amusing ones. If you are so convinced that humans are responsible for global warming, well, we don't really talk about global warming, but I do believe humans are responsible. So why don't you cut your off and do your bit to save the world? Well, I felt like replying saying, well, you're a bit late. I have three kids, so I have procreated, so I have increased the global population. But the first author is Andrew Kemp. He hasn't had any kids, so maybe he could do his bit to try and stop the global population topping 7 billion, which it will later this month. And then obviously on your papers you put your email address, so fellow academics can contact you regarding the data, but that also means that you get emails from the general public. And so when we published the paper, I was usually getting about 50 abusive emails every day for the first few weeks. It now slows down, but we got this one the other day. It says, wow, professor, did you ever hear of emerging or submerging coastlines as described in most geology textbooks? Well, I am in an earth science department, so I said yes. In any case, what an analysis on your part, especially your disclaimer noted therein. Please take your global warming crap to another level. Honest, for starters, you fool no one. So I thought I'd now try and give you the science behind climate change. And you can sit there and think that if I'm lying to you and see whether you should be concerned about this problem. So what do we know about sea level? So this graph shows time along the x-axis, okay, going from 1850 AD, beginning of the Industrial Revolution, going through to a projection in 2100. And here's sea level. Three types of data here. We have geological, which I'm going to concentrate mainly on in this presentation, in the blue. We have our tide gauges. Our tide gauges are recording a global mean sea level rise of somewhere between 1.5 and 2 millimetres, depending upon the time span. We then have the satellite observations, which have noted an acceleration. Acceleration is, again, between about 2.8 to over 3 millimetres, again, depending upon the time span. There is unequivocal evidence that global mean sea level is rising. We also know what the contributing factors are. So if we look at a segment of the tide gauge record, 1961 to 2003, 1.6 millimeter rise, we know that it's controlled by thermal expansion. You heat water up, it occupies a greater space, sea levels rise. You warm temperatures, glaciers or ice in glaciers and ice caps and on ice sheets is going to melt, and they have a contributing factor. If we look at another time period where we have an acceleration in the rate of sea level rise, these factors slightly change and our ice sheets are now a greater component. Continental ice sheets are now 40%. Thermal expansion. How do we know about thermal expansion? Well, our satellites and our buoys in our ocean waters have been recording this, and we have this graph showing 1978 to 2002. And we see that, like global warming, there's spatial variability. So not all of the areas have been increasing in their temperatures, but predominantly the northern hemisphere shown here shows temperatures rising in our oceans, therefore they're going to occupy greater space, therefore sea level must rise, and some of the temperatures are quite predominantly warm and they're in the upper latitudes, which is very unfortunate for the extent of sea ice. We then have many beautiful photos that start to illustrate the changing in our distributions of glaciers and ice caps on our planet. Here we have 1934, same time of year in 2011. Huge changes in the distribution. And to try and give you an angle on how on the magnitude of size, if we just look at this little yellow box shown there, that's what it is. We have this little, maybe have this person here, it's about a 30 kilometer peak of ice. So you can start to indicate the scale of the ice melting from these ice caps. Now, science is always changing. So if you'd asked a scientist who looks into ice sheets, a glaciologist, what was the response time of an ice sheet to rising temperatures 20 years or so ago, people would say, well, the response time would be about 1,000 years. Some people may say centuries. Very few people would say decades, and nobody would really say weeks or months. However, observations of our ice sheets that we've had through satellite-based information have shown pronounced changes in our ice sheets in very short timescales. So here we are. This is the Larsen Shelf on the Western Antarctic Peninsula, and all these areas of green are areas where ice shelves have been lost. This is quite a famous one. It's known as Larsen B, which disintegrated over not thousands of years, not centuries, not decades, not even annually. Within the space of about 5 weeks, an area of Rhode Island completely and utterly disintegrated. This is on the 31st of January, moving through to the 5th of March. All due to rising temperatures, or predominantly due to rising temperatures, of around 2.5 degrees C in the West Antarctic Peninsula in the last 50 years. So we know what's happening with sea level in the present. And we know what the contributing factors are, but we are unable to accurately predict what the effects will be in the 21st century. Yes, sea level will rise, but we have a large range of projections, which are shown here. So we have the sea level rise in centimetres and all different types of models. So the IPCC, which is thought to be alarmist, I would actually say is very conservative, projects that sea level by 2100 will be about 18 to 60 or 70 centimetres, depending on the range of temperature increase. We have these other models, which are semi-empirical. They're based upon building up a relationship between the observed temperatures of the 20th century and the observed sea levels. So you build up this relationship and you project it into the future. And they have huge increases, up to greater than 2 meters by 2100. Another problem is that there's huge spatial variability in sea level rise. So this is from the satellite measurements, so the trend in sea level over the last 20 years. And you see some areas, if we remember the average is somewhere between 2.5 and 3 millimetres in this time period, some areas have an order of magnitude greater, around 20 millimetres, whether other areas are falling. And if we're thinking about the US alone, along the Pacific coast, sea level has been falling over the last 20 years. Along the Gulf coast, it's been accelerating up to 10 millimetres per year. And along the Atlantic coast, it is very, very variable. Why? Well, that's because sea level is a very, very complex phenomena. If we're going to talk about sea level rise, we first of all need to be able to predict what's going to happen in our oceans. How much density changes? So if the oceans are going to warm up, how much is it going to expand? What are going to be the influences of ocean circulation, such as the Gulf Stream? What is going to be the interaction with atmospheric stable and unstable cyclones and anticyclones? What is going to be the terrestrial water storage that we use? But then as we're talking about the coastlines, you not only have the oceans, you have the land. And our land levels will change. We know that they will change rapidly in the response to earthquakes, but over long time periods, we will also get the response to former loads on our planet's surface. In particular, the land levels will change in the response to extinct ice sheets that existed at the last glacial maximum. So our ocean levels, well, what do we know about our oceans? Well, we go to tropical localities and we take samples of corals. And this graph shows a time scale from 25,000 to 5,000 years and a sea level from 150 meters below present to zero. At 20,000 years ago, you had two colossal ice sheets on our planet, covering much of northwestern Europe, all of Canada, and significant parts of the United States. As temperatures rose, I'm not a liar, as temperatures rose, sea level rose, and it rose dramatically, rising around 120 to 140 meters in 15,000 years. What about our land? Well, this is something that is quite complex to understand, but our land level changes will change in space or in time, dependent upon their relationship to the extinct ice sheets. So we've got three locations, A, B, and C. Time, T1 going through to T5. If you were underneath an ice sheet, such as Hudson Bay, the land level subsided as you had this huge weight placed upon it to the last glacial maximum around 20,000 years ago, and then the land level uplifted as this ice sheet receded. So you can see this in this cross-section, land subsided, and then land uplifted. If you were at the margins of the ice sheet, so just outside the ice sheet, the land uplifted at the last glacial maximum and then subsided as we went through to the present day, T4. We're not back at T5. So we still have these processes taking place, and they're huge. Areas underneath the ice sheet, such as Hudson Bay, are currently uplifting at around 12 millimeters per year. So let's just think of that with values. So the tide gauges and the satellites are showing our oceans are going up at 3 millimeters per year, but our land is uplifting at 12 millimeters per year. So sea level isn't rising there, sea level is falling by about 9 millimeters. Land isn't being lost, land is being created. However, in areas where the land is subsiding, the effect of sea level rise is more critical. So if we went back through time, these processes are very, very profound. So what we have here is that we can subdivide the world into different regions, show very different sea level responses. So if we just look at the Atlantic coast of North America, we can have areas where sea level's actually fallen for over 6,000 years, because although the oceans are rising because of the melting of the ice sheets, the land uplift outstrips it. We can have very complicated, where you get rise and fall, or you can have continually rising curves where you have our ocean rise and you have your land subsidence. So what I suggest is that there is an urgent need for past sea level data. Now, it's not a surprise I'm going to say that. I'm an earth scientist. If I didn't say that, I wouldn't have anything to do. But we need past data to fully understand that relationship of climate and sea level and fully understand that spatial information. So what we can do is, if we have geological data, it can provide the background to compare against our observations. And indeed, if we can have continuous records, we can find out when it changed and start to build up our climate sea level relations. So how do we reconstruct sea level? And this is really what my undergraduate graduates and our postdoc students do. We go out to various parts around the planet and we reconstruct sea level. How are you able to do that? Well, you must have a geological, biological, chemical indicator that has a relationship to sea level. So along the US Atlantic coast, what we have are wetlands, and wetlands have beautiful, precise indicators that can be compared to sea level. So you can find tidal flat communities, and we know that they must be anywhere below mean tide level. We can have our upland communities, our forests, and we know that they must be above mean high water. And then along our wetlands, potentially we can identify different types of plants, and they have differing relationships between highest astronomical tide and mean high water, or in a low marsh between mean high water and mean tide level. So we look at the modern environment as the way of interpreting the past. So if we look at this particular, this is from North Carolina. Here we have our upland area, high marsh grass, hopefully you can see there, low marsh and tidal flat. On this one from New Jersey, we've now identified the particular species, not just sub-environments, pine and oak woodlands, Phragmites, grasses, and then different Spartina species. Our altitude is decreasing, our inundation is increasing, and therefore our plants become more salt tolerant. So once you've understood the modern, you can go back in time. So you take a core, or you look at a bank section, so you know your depth. Through geodetic means, you work out its elevation. And then you take samples out, an upland, a low marsh grass, a high marsh grass, and a marine sample from a shell. And because of the known relationship in the modern, you can produce a curve. We can date each one of these that give you the age, and you know your elevation of relative sea level. So you can provide that information. Now we can take these, we can take our core through coring through lakes to find the marine salt marsh boundary. We can take cores on salt marshes. So this is an Atlantic City. You can see it in the background. This is a salt marsh. Or we can dig big trenches through the salt marsh material. We take our cores, we bring them back to our laboratory, we do analytical analysis on it. Indeed, you can just pick out parts of your cores and they show a changing sea level history by looking at the different types of stems, rhizomes, and seeds in our plants. So you're recording how the salt marsh is changing in response to sea level. Fortunately, these organic remains have carbon within them. And carbon can be radiometrically dated. So not only do you know where sea level is, through radiometrically dating, you can identify exactly when it was. So we've done this type of study along the whole of the US Atlantic coast. We're just looking at the mid-Atlantic coast here. So we have different types of data points, and I've drawn this black line to guide your eye. So going from New York to the eastern shore of the Dalvamar Peninsula. And all of these areas show rising sea level, because in this area, it's on the forebulge, so the land is subsiding. It's at the periphery of that ice sheet. So the land is subsiding, and our oceans are rising. But there are huge spatial variations in this. Let's just look at this graph. So here we have the eastern shore of the Dalvamar Peninsula. At 6,000 years ago, sea level was about 8 meters below present. Let's go to New Jersey, only a couple of hundred kilometers further north. At 6,000 years ago, it was around 15 meters below present. So a 7 to 8 meter difference in sea level due to differing effects of coastal subsidence. You have greater subsidence in New Jersey because it's more the center of that forebulge collapse than the eastern shore of the Dalvamar Peninsula. Now, they're rather abstract graphs. What about actually looking at how our coastlines responded through time? So this is a map of the mid-Atlantic coastline. Here's the present-day shoreline, Chesapeake, Delaware, we're here, going through to New York. And then at 10,000 years ago, here we are at 10,000 years ago, here is the shoreline. So the green to the turquoise, this line here, is the shoreline at 10,000 years ago. And these are on display at the Franklin Institute. We have an animation of this sort of work. So we're just going to run through this. And what I want you to realize is that as sea level is rising, the land is eroding, it is retreating very, very rapidly. 10, 9, we've got a creation of an island out into the Atlantic. 8, 7, 7,000 years, this island just has two promontories out there. We're starting to get the formation of the coastline that we know today. 6,000 years, 5,000 years. And 4,000 years. At around 4,000 years ago, all our ice sheets have gone. So the melting from those two ice sheets in northwestern Europe and Laurentide, they both disappeared. And so all we're left with now is the slow coastal substance from the extinct ice sheets that causes the creation of the estuaries and the modern shoreline we see today. 3, 2, 1. 0. Quite a dramatic change in our coastlines when sea level was rising very rapidly. Gives us an analogy with what will happen in the future with predicted sea levels. Now we can use that geological data to provide background rates. So we selected the last 4,000 years because those ice sheets had gone, and we just basically, for each region along the US Atlantic coast, we plotted up our sea level data. So we have time here, 4,000 and sea level, ran a linear regression through this, and this gives you your background rates of sea level rise without prior to any eustatic import or ocean level import in the 20th century. And we can see in zone one, we have sea level rising at less than 1 millimeter. It accelerates to around 2 millimeters in the mid-Atlantic coastline, a hot spot where we're stood. The land level here is subsiding at around 2 millimeters per year. So you come back here this time next year Irving Hall will be about 2 millimetres lower. And then we have zone 3 as you go into the Carolinas back to 1 millimetre. So that's the average for the last 4,000 years. So the simplest thing to do is just to compare that with the tide gauges. So what do we show here? Remember, in the northeastern corner, we had less than 1 millimetre. We're now going up to 2 millimetres. In the mid-Atlantic, we had up to 2 millimetres. We're now at 3 millimetres. Go down into the southern areas, it was less than 1 millimetre. We have over 3 millimetres. So you can produce a nice plot, very simple. It doesn't involve models. It is just data. We have our tide gauge data for the US Atlantic coast and the average over the last 4,000 years. If there was no acceleration in sea level, they'd all lie along that line. The rate you got in the tide gauge would be exactly the same as the rate you got for the last 4,000 years, but it isn't. They're all between 1 and 2 and 3 millimetres. The average of all this states that sea level rise on average for the US Atlantic coast is around 1.8 millimetres in the 20th century. The next stage is to say, okay, so our geological data against our tide gauges and our satellite has shown a separation. But we need to know when that has occurred. What was it related to? Can you pin it on the Industrial Revolution and the increase in fossil fuels? So we need to do far more detailed reconstructions from our salt marshes. Because then what we can do is, if we have a continuous record of sea level, our projections, our models that project into the future, you can drive them through to the past and hopefully improve the accuracy of those projections. So this is a record from North Carolina. So this is some data from Andy. This was part of the paper from the National Academy. We had two sites in North Carolina, Sandpoint and Tumpoint, about 120 kilometers apart. They're very different marshes. One is a freshwater, one is very saline. And the great thing about this is that our two records overlapped. Gave us great confidence that we were recording the natural response of that system to a change in sea level. We also compared it with our observational record, and hopefully you'll agree with me that this is a beautiful record, a beautiful fit. You know, our salt marshes are beautifully recording the change in sea level over that last 70 or so years. And because of the fit of the two records and the fit with the tide gauge, it provides great confidence of pushing it back through time. So this is what we have here. This is the first continuous record of sea level over the last 2,000 years. It's never been done at this resolution before, and Andy completed this in his PhD. So we have sea level here going from around minus 2.5 to zero, and here's our time span. Zero AD, Roman period, going through to present. We find sea level is rising, and then it accelerates. Now, it is rising because of the coastal subsidence that we showed you in the previous graphs. So if we detrend it or adjust it for this subsidence that's a relic of the last glacial maximum, isn't related to climate, present-day climate processes, we have the following graph. So here we have GIA-adjusted, glacial ice static, the land-level subsidence adjusted sea level goes from about minus 0.4 of a metre to 0.2, and here we have our timescales. So we have a stable period of sea level. Sea level really doesn't do anything from about 200 BC going up to around 900 AD. Then sea level rises around 0.6 of a millimetre. That period coincides with what is known as the medieval climate anomaly, or the medieval warm period, where we know from temperature records that the temperatures in the northern hemisphere increased. Sea level rises for some 350 years, then it's stable or falls. It's falling at a rate of around minus 0.1 of a millimetre. That is in the period of the Little Ice Age, where again we know it's a period where climate cooled, where our glaciers expanded, where there was thermal contraction, so sea level cooled. And then we run to this period. Between 1865 and 1892, at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, a very sharp change occurred, where sea level rose to 2.1 millimetres per year. So that was the steepest increase over the whole 2,000 years. Then what can we do? Well, the next stage was saying, right, okay, well, we've shown this data, so let's start to think about developing our own semi-empirical models. So as I said, those models that were projecting temperature and sea level for the future are based around a relationship between temperature and sea level over only 100, 120 years. We've got 2,000 years of sea level data, and we can get a similar amount of temperature data by looking at tree ring records. So Andy built up a semi-empirical model, which is shown in the black, based upon the relationship between temperature and sea level over 2,000 years. And then we can compare that with the proxy data, and we show a beautiful fit. So are we now starting to get to a better understanding of what sea level will be in the 21st century? So then this graph again shows time from 1,000 to 2,000. Again, it's trying to illustrate to you that the 20th century is an anomaly. The rates of sea level rise in the 20th century are far greater than anything seen. So here's the the mean of our semi-empirical of our proxy data, and here's the model being driven by natural and also anthropogenic forcing. Then obviously what we can do is project the future. So our model suggests that if we have a warming of around 1.8 degrees C by 2100, we will get a sea level of around 1 meter rise. Now, that's a global mean sea level. It says nothing about spatial variability. If obviously we get an increase in that temperature, so it goes above 2 degrees by, that should have a two there. So it should go above 2 degrees by AD 2100, that will increase. If we keep that lower, then that will decrease. So just as a final slide, it's just to say that, well, global sea levels have risen through the 20th century. There's no doubt about that. It's just data. I mean, there's no reason to suspect that that data is faulty. And these rises will continue in the 21st century, and they almost certainly will accelerate because our temperatures are increasing at an increasing magnitude. However, we don't know what the magnitude is yet. We've done one proxy record from North Carolina and correlated it. We need many more proxy records. But it took Andy 5 years of his PhD, 5 years of his life to produce that record. We need many more people who are going to donate 5 years of their life to working with me, which is a whole different ball game. We also don't know the amplitude of the regional variations. We now know what it's going to be in North Carolina, but what else is it along the US Atlantic coast? How does it differ in Florida or in Maine? Let's go to Europe. Let's go to the Southern Hemisphere, etc. Both of these are uncertain. And what is needed is bright young minds like you guys to answer these questions. Because otherwise, you know, we're going to get more road closures due to sea level rise. It's a great photo. Thank you very much. I'm open to any questions. Hi. Yeah, I mean, that's based upon geological data. So if you go back through geological time, you find these events called Heinrich events, where huge amounts of glaciers came out of Canada and Greenland, and they put a large amount of fresh water into the Gulf Stream. So the Gulf Stream circulation is part of the thermohaline, the global circulation, and it's driven predominantly by salinity. It's a very warm saline water, the Gulf Stream. So it goes up into the northern part of the Atlantic, and it's very dense. What happens to dense things? They sink, and it drives this conveyor. However, if you put large amounts of fresh water into it, it isn't dense anymore, and the whole thing stops. And that has happened through geological time, and we've been able to identify these events. But one of the big problems is what magnitude. We don't know what magnitude. So there has been some thoughts in the 20th century that because of the increase in temperature, it's a cyclical phenomena. Because of the increase in temperature, we're melting, we're carving more icebergs out of Greenland, which is putting fresh water into that system. So But it's very hard to work out the magnitude that you need to start to slow down the thermohaline. And indeed, it's incredibly hard to observe it. How do you observe a slowing down of a circulatory cell that has thousands of sphaedrons, the volume of water being migrated along our planet? But geologically, you go back through time, these events have happened. So if they've happened in the past, they will occur in the future at some point. It may not be within 1,000 or 10,000 years, but there can be effects. And the effects of shutting that down are phenomenal for the globe. So when they shut down, the Earth enters an ice age. That's one of the effects, one of the feedback mechanisms. Yep.
Do you use high-performance computing and cluster computing in your research to like generate the future models?
Well, we don't do it, but we work with people who do. I mean, I think that obviously when you have graduate students, you want to expose them to all different types of problems, but you can't be a jack-of-all-trades. You know, you have to be a master of one. And in my group, we've become a master of reconstructing sea level in the past as accurate. The thing about it at the moment is that we're able to do this, which I think 10 years ago, we weren't able to do this. We're now really high precision, so a modeler is now really interested in our data. Previously, we'd have huge gaps, and our data points would be this big. And the modeler would go, well, it wouldn't provide any constraints to me. So now we have this data, we're now, you know, so the paper that we wrote, the oceanographic modeler we worked with was Stefan Ramsdorf from Potsdam, and he did the modeling. We also, to do with the land level changes, we observe the land level changes, then we work with a modeler who can model land level changes anywhere around the globe, so he constrains it to our data. So it would be great if there was someone in my group who could do that, but I don't have the expertise to particularly train them, but, you know, you be a nice guy, you know, you buy a couple of beers and you can get yourself into any group, and that's, but we have really good data, which is the key. Yep. Well, I mean, we get our funding from blue chip company. I mean, as in NASA, NOAA, NSF. You know, our group is very fortunate. I've had very good graduate and postdoctoral students who are producing this type of unprecedented data. So we're well funded by, you know, we've got a big grant from NOAA, and I've got grants from NSF and NASA. So we haven't looked at the, let's say, the private sector. But as I said right at the start, I think it is paramount importance for me, and I try and instill this, that we take our data out and it is useful now. I mean, I think even the NSF, we have to write a lot about our broader outreach. And so we can't just write a series of papers. We have to actually go to people in North Carolina State and say, look, this is what's happening. But it is a very emotive subject. North Carolina is sort of a hotbed of this political activity. It has a coastline that is very susceptible to sea level rise, with the Outer Banks just sticking out there. A large proportion of their economy is due to coast. And me going there saying that you've got sea level rise and your coastline's going to change, they don't particularly like. But I don't tell them what to do. I just want to provide the information. But we have, from those websites, they just think our data is completely flawed. So we sometimes, to coin a phrase, we're battling against the tide or the wave of public opinion that we're flawed in this science. And so we have to try and alter that. I'm not going to tell people what the cost-benefit analysis of, we were just talking about this previously, of building a new causeway in the Outer Banks to enable the tourists to reach the areas. I'm not going to say whether that is cost-effective. That's for an economist to work out. But they have to accept that sea level is going to rise. They have to accept that we don't know how much it's going to rise. But if we are, hopefully, in the next 10 to 15 years, that range will start to come down as the global mean, but then it will blow up to do with spatial variability, and we'll be able to say for 2100, what was sea level going to be? Or what is sea level going to be for North Carolina, for Delaware, you know, for Jersey, for New York, etc. Any other questions? Does that mean I can have a slice of pizza now? Okay, thank you very much. They were great questions. Thank you.
this up for you. Go ahead and get some pizza.
Yeah.